Hello everyone. In the previous lecture, you have listened to the introduction of fuels. What is a fuel? A fuel is that substance which on burning gives lot amount of energy. And one of the most important solid natural fuel is coal. So in this lecture, we'll study about the rank, characteristics and analysis of coal. Now, what is coal? Coal is a highly carbonaceous matter formed as a result of alteration of vegetable matter. What happens is when plants or trees get uprooted and submerged under the earth, with the passage of time, in the presence of high temperature, pressure and absence of oxygen, slowly gets transformed into coal. It mainly consists of elements like carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen and some non-combustible inorganic matter. Now, the classification of coal is based on the rank. Now, what is this rank? Rank is nothing but it is the measure of carbon content. That means in the transformation, what happens is the percentage of carbon increases, its hardness increases and the moisture content decreases. Also, the elements percentage, that is hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen and sulfur percentage decreases. Now, based on these parameters, let's quickly see the classification or transformation of wood into the qualities of coal. Now, in the first stage, we call it as peat. When wood gets transformed into coal, the first stage in its transformation is called as peat. Peat is nothing but it is a loose light brown solid. It is regarded as a first stage in the formation of coal. It contains maximum percentage of water. Now, if you see the percentage of carbon here, it has about 57% of carbon with the least calorific value of about 5400 kilocal per kg. So, right. Next, we go to lignite. Lignite is a soft brown colored solid with also adequate amount of water, and percentage of carbon here is almost about 70% of carbon, and its calorific value is 6500 to 7000 kilocal per kg. Now, next one we have is bituminous coal. This bituminous coal is a dark brown solid with calorific value of about 7000 kilocal per kg. It has about 80% or almost 83% of carbon content. Now, finally, we have highest rank coal, which is called as anthracite, with the highest percentage of carbon, that is 92 to 98% of carbon. Now, it has the highest calorific value, that is 8600 to almost about 8700 kilocal per kg. So you can see, students, that basically when we talk about the lowest quality, that is peat, and coming to the highest quality, this is anthracite, the percentage of carbon drastically increases. We can see here in the peat it is 60% of carbon, and in anthracite it is almost about 98% of carbon. Right, this is what is the difference here. As the percentage of carbon increases, the hardness and the quality of coal also increases. So the cheapest form or the first quality, that means the lowest quality in the transformation of coal, is peat, and the highest quality is anthracite. So this is what is the classification of coal. Now, we have got coal samples and it's now our responsibility to analyze the coal. Now, in order to analyze, in order to find out the quality of coal, whether it has got a good quality, whether it can be used for commercial purpose or not, we need to analyze it. We need to test it. We need to find out its quality. And the test or the analyzing can be done based on some parameters. Now, if you have some parameters, preliminary parameters like moisture, volatile impurities, only the preliminary parameters are taken into consideration. then that analysis is what is called as proximate analysis. So I repeat once again, if you are checking or if you are finding or if you are analyzing the quality of coal by making use of the preliminary parameters, then it is called as proximate analysis. And if you go further, you are checking its percentage of carbon along with some other elements, then we call it as ultimate analysis. So we are considering these two types of analysis, that is proximate analysis and ultimate analysis. Both these two analyses are done to determine the quality of coal. Now, next one we have is the first one, that is proximate analysis. So, as I told you already, that proximate analysis is a check that is done to find out the quality of coal based on preliminary parameters. Now, what are those parameters? Quickly, let us see. The first one we have is moisture. Now, moisture, what are we doing? Let's see the experiment actually, first one. So, what we do is, we are taking initially 1 gram of the powdered air-dried sand of coal, and before we start it, the experiment, before we heat it, what we do is, we take the sample and we weigh it. So, it will have some weight, and after that, we are putting in the crucible. As you know, crucible is a small cup-like structure. This crucible is placed inside in a hot air oven and it is heated. So you all can see, students, here this one is oven, and here we have a thermostat to maintain or regulate the temperature, and in hot air oven we send dry heat for maintaining that dry conditions. Mostly what happens here is, in the absence of moisture, that means there will be no moisture here. So in the absence of moisture, what happens? We are heating in this hot air oven maintained at a temperature of 105 to 110 degrees centigrade. So you all can understand that why we have applied the temperature. Whatever the moisture that we have, almost it gets evaporated. So initially, before we heat it, before that we weigh it, and after heating also we take it out, and for 1 hour we do this heating, and afterwards we take it out and we cool it in the desiccator. So I'll show you what is a desiccator. Yeah, this one is a desiccator, students, here. Now, desiccator is something which is concealed here. It is an apparatus where we don't allow any moisture to go inside, and it is practically used for those chemicals which need to be protected from moisture. So this is what is a desiccator, where there is completely moisture free chemicals are used. Now, so this one, yeah, in the hot air oven, after we take it out, we cool it here, we cool it in desiccator, and again we wait. As you all know, students, that before we heat it, we have already weighed it, and after heating also again we are weighing. Definitely there will be a loss in the weight, and we attribute this loss in the weight due to moisture, because the temperature is suitably applicable to the moisture or water vapor. Now, when what happens here is, we find out the percentage of moisture. Now, percentage of moisture is, we get it from this formula. Percentage of moisture is equal to loss in the weight. That means before heating, after heating, whatever the weights were there, the difference in the weight is loss in the weight by weight of coal taken. This is the weight of coal here into 100. So this is what is the percentage of moisture. Now, next one is, here, why should we actually perform this experiment to find out the percentage of moisture? Now, moisture is that particular, you know, it is the parameter that is present in the coal, which adds weight to the coal. But is it contributing to any energy contribution? No, because when you heat coal, what happens is moisture gets evaporated and it just goes off, it escapes off without giving any energy contribution. And one more thing is, it quenches off the fire. You know what is the quenching? Quenching is putting off the fire. That is what is called as moisture. Now, here, so that is the problem of moisture, students. Number one, moisture adds weight to the coal without any energy contribution. Number two, quenches the fire. It doesn't allow the fire to burn. I mean, it doesn't allow the burning capacity of the coal. So thereby what happens is, if moisture is present in the coal, it decreases the calorific value of the coal. But a percentage of about 10% is always better for the quality of coal, because it burns with a uniform burning and with a less amount of flash. Okay. The next one is proximate. In that proximate analysis, we are checking the next parameter, that is volatile matter. Now, what is this volatile matter? We'll see it. But before that, let's do the experiment. What are we doing here? We are taking the dried sample of coal left in the crucible. What we have taken the crucible in the coal sample in the crucible in the step one, that same dried sample one of coal we are taking, and now we are putting in the electrical furnace. You can see this one is the muffle furnace. Now this is provided, you can see all of you, this is provided at a temperature of 925 or to 930 degrees centigrade, students. Now here, what happens here is, slightly the temperature is quite high, because now the parameter or the problem for the coal is volatile matter. This volatile matter completely gets distilled off when the temperature is above 900. So again, before we put it for heating, again we first find out the weight, and after some time, after we heat it, after we put it in the oven, after 7 minutes of heating away, again we take it out and it is cooled first in the air. So now we can cool it in the air, because it is now not the problem of the moisture. We take it in the desiccator and again we find out its weight. So now the difference in the weight is because of the loss of volatile matter. That means before we put it in the muffle furnace, or before we put it in the electrical furnace, we find it, we take its weight. After 7 minutes of heating, again we find its weight. Definitely there is a loss in the weight, and this loss in the weight is because of the loss or the removal of volatile matter. So again we find out the percentage of volatile matter, students, here. So this is, this loss of percentage of volatile matter is given by the formula: the loss in the weight due to the removal of volatile matter by the initial weight of coal taken, and it is into 100. Now, what is the problem of volatile matter? What is this volatile matter? Volatile matter is present in the coal, and definitely it adds weight to the coal. Along with that, what happens is, when coal is used for burning, I mean when coal has to be burnt, what happens is, much amount of the volatile impurities, it escapes off or it gets distilled off without giving any energy contribution to the coal. That means they are only present physically, but without any energy contribution, they just escape off. And this high volatile matter, when it burns with a long flame, high smoke, and that's the reason also is accountable for the pollution. So this way, volatile matter is another problem to the coal, which is a non-combustible impurity. So in the first slide, before I've given you the introduction, in the introduction part of the analysis, non-combustible matter means it can be moisture. It is the next one, it is volatile matter. That is, they are present in the coal, but without any energy contribution, they just escape off, they distill off. That is why it is called as non-combustible matter. So next one we have is ash. This is a most important non-combustible matter, which is maximum only present in the solid fuels. Now, to find out the percentage of ash, let's do this experiment. What are we doing? We are taking this coal and it is heated without lid in the muffle furnace. In an oven, we are heating at a temperature of about 700 degrees centigrade. Please be careful about the temperatures, because for water the temperature was about 100 to 110. For the volatile impurities it was more than 900, and now for the ash it is 700 degrees centigrade. So for almost after half an hour you take it out. After heating for half an hour you take it out, cool it first in air, then in the desiccated again we wait. So then what happens is, ash is a final residue that is obtained in the burning process of coal. So there is, we need to heat it, cool it, again wait, heat, cool, and again wait till we get the constancy in the weight. When we get weight, there is no change in the weight. When we get constancy in the weight, then we finally assume that the final residue, that is ash, has been obtained. Now to find out the percentage of ash, we use this formula. So as you all know that now there is no difference in the weight, students, here, because finally whatever is the residue that is obtained, it is the last residue that is obtained in the burning process of coal. So weight of ash by weight of coal taken into 100. This is what is the percentage used. This is a formula used to find out the percentage of ash. Now, what is this ash? Ash is nothing but it is a non-combustible matter which reduces the calorific value of the coal. Why? How does it reduce? What happens, students, here, when coal burns, I mean in the initial part or the burning process of coal, some amount of coal, when it starts burning, it changes into ash. Now this ash falls and it would be acting as a hindrance. It doesn't allow the oxygen supply. Thereby what happens is there is no combustion process continued. So heating capacity or the burning process of the coal gradually decreases. That is what is the problem of ash. Ash is present in the coal, that is, it is a non-combustible matter without any contribution to the energy contribution to the, or the calorific value to the coal. First point. Second one is, it is present and which is acting as a hindrance. It is blocking the air spaces between the fuel, not allowing any amount of oxygen to go into the coal and help in the burning process. So it acts, it blocks the spaces. That's the reason why it decreases the calorific value of the coal. Now this, what happens here is, because of this, what happens, the burning process gradually becomes irregular. So we say that lower the ash content, better is the quality of coal. So that's what is the same thing about the moisture, students. Moisture content should be low in order to have good quality of coal, or in order to have high calorific value of the coal. Same is the case with the volatile matter. Volatile matter also should be in the least ratio or the least percentage for to have the good quality of coal, for the burning process of the coal. And finally, ash also should be in the least proportionate, so that, because you can't avoid all this, but only we can say that they should be present in the minimum percentage, the least percentage, in order to have highest calorific value of the coal. So these are called, these are the parameters to check the proximate, I mean, this is the analysis which is called as proximate analysis. These are the preliminary characteristics or the parameters used to check the quality of coal. Now we go to the next, the most important analysis, which doesn't check the preliminary, but most important is percentage of carbon. As I told you, in the transformation of coal, students, based on the percentage of carbon, the highest quality or the good quality of coal, that is anthracite, we call it as. So definitely, based on the percentage of carbon and other elements like oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, all these elements, based on those percentage, we decide the good quality or whether it is, it has highest calorific value or not. So let's go this. Now, but before that, how do we get this fixed carbon? Let's see. The percentage of fixed carbon is equal to 100%, means taken all the parameters, students, here, that is moisture, and volatile impurities and ash, all the three. So all the three parameters, when you add whatever the percentage we get from those formulas we have used, from that, if you subtract from 100, we get the fixed carbon. So this will be the basis for the ultimate analysis, students. Greater the fixed carbon, greater is the calorific value, or the better is the quality of coal. So this finishes your proximate analysis. Now, as I told you, ultimate analysis. Ultimate analysis is a check that is used to find out the percentage of carbon and other elements, because these elements decides the most important calorific value of the coal, that is heat capacity or the burning capacity of the coal. Now, how do we do this and how is the experiment performed? Let's see. So in the determination, first one is, as I told you, percentage of carbon forms the basis for the calorific value or the heating capacity of coal. So in order to find out the percentage of carbon and hydrogen, what we do is, here you are able to see that we take here coal, the sample of coal which need to be tested, and we are heating in the presence of pure dry oxygen. Here the combustion is done, and what happens is, the carbon that is present in the coal, it burns in the presence of oxygen and it is entering into this particular tubes. There are two tubes you can see here. One tube is with calcium chloride, anhydrous calcium chloride solution here. That means anhydrous calcium chloride. And this particular tube, it is filled with potassium hydroxide solution. Now, this particular tube, which is filled with KOH solution, potassium hydroxide solution, is used to find out the percentage of carbon. And this particular tube is used to find out the percentage of hydrogen. So now, this tube, students, here, anhydrous calcium chloride, that means without moisture, without water. So what happens here is, the percentage of hydrogen, when you have hydrogen burns in the presence of oxygen and forms water. This water vapor, when it enters, before the entry of water vapor, what we do is, actually we find out the weight of this particular tube. We find out the weight of this tube and find out the initial weight of this particular tube. And after we allow this one here, when this water vapor enters into this tube, then what happens is, calcium chloride absorbs this moisture and forms hydrated. So there will be increase in the weight of the tube because of the absorption of moisture, that is water vapor. So before we start the experiment, before we allow the entry of water vapor, we have seen the weight of this tube, and after the entry of water vapor, there is another weight that is obtained. All of you can judge that now the weight of the tube is going to increase because of the entry of water vapor. So as it is, based on that, let's see the formula here. Now, you all know that this is what is the formula here. In 18 grams of water, you have 2 grams of hydrogen. Therefore, whatever the water vapor is coming out from this burning process of coal, how much is the percentage of hydrogen? So, that's how you calculate the percentage of hydrogen. Now, same is the case with carbon. So, when this carbon, along with oxygen in the burning process, in the presence of oxygen because of formation of CO2, it enters into this particular tube containing KOH solution. Now, this KOH solution is basic in nature. So, CO2 is acidic oxide, students, here. You can see that KOH in the presence of carbon dioxide forms K2CO3, that's a salt. And thereby what happens, again, there is a increase in the weight. So, for this tube also, before we pass carbon dioxide gas, we find the initial weight of the tube containing KOH solution. Again, after the entry of CO2 gas, that is carbon dioxide gas, again we find out the weight. The increase in the weight is because of the entry of carbon dioxide. So now, again, let's see the weight percentage of carbon. Here, you know that the molecular weight of carbon dioxide is 44. In 44 grams of carbon dioxide, 12 grams of carbon is present. So whatever is the increase, why did it increase? The weight of the KOH solution tube has increased. Why? It's because of the increase, the entry of carbon dioxide. So that is what? Increase in the weight of a KOH tube means, why is it has increased? It is because of the entry of CO2 gas. Why it is increased the calcium chloride tube? It is because of the entry of water vapor, that is H2O. So this is how we find out the percentage of carbon and hydrogen. I hope it is clear here. That means in 44 grams of carbon dioxide, we have 12 grams of carbon. And in the KOH tube, whatever the amount of carbon dioxide has entered, how much is the percentage of carbon? That is what is the percentage, how we calculate. Same thing, students, here. In 18 grams of water vapor, we have 2 grams of hydrogen. And in the calcium chloride tube, the tube containing calcium chloride, H2O, that is water vapor has entered, that water vapor has, or H2O, it has how many grams of hydrogen? From that, we calculate the percentage of hydrogen. Now, this forms the basis, the most important two elements which decides the calorific value of the coal. Next. Well, let's see why this carbon and hydrogen forms the basis or most important to determine the calorific value of the coal. So, percentage of carbon, maximum it has highest percentage of calorific, it has high calorific value, students, here 8080 kilocal per kg. Maximum percentage is given by carbon followed with the hydrogen. So, greater the percentage of carbon, greater is the calorific value of the coal. But in the presence of hydrogen, hydrogen also supports combustion. What happens here is hydrogen maximum, it is associated with the oxygen in the form of hydrogen. That is, it combines with oxygen and forms moisture. So, because of the presence of moisture, calorific value slightly decreases. That's the reason we have, that is, mostly hydrogen is present in the form of fixed hydrogen. So, greater the percentage of carbon, greater is the calorific value. And that is the reason why we have classified the coal in the transformation of coal formation. The percentage of carbon forms a basis in the decision making of quality of the coal. We say that anthracite is the best quality or the highest quality of coal because it has the maximum, that is 92 to 98% of carbon. Carbon forms the basis of the calorific value for the burning capacity of the coal. Now, next one is another important element, that is nitrogen. Now, in order to know about its percentage, we have the experiment. This long necked flask in your lower classes, you must have studied about the percentage of the nitrogen determination, which is called as Jaeldal's flask. Long neck flask, which is used in the determination of nitrogen, that is long, this is Jaeldal's flask. What we are doing is, we are taking 1 gram of the weight powdered coal and we are heating in the presence of concentrated sulfuric acid, in the presence of potassium sulfate, which acts as a catalyst. Now, after the solution becomes clear, what happens is we are treating in the presence of potassium hydroxide. So, when you are heating here in the presence of potassium hydroxide, what happens here is ammonia gets released. Now, as you all know that ammonia being a base, we need to titrate with some standard volume of acid. So, ammonia being base, what happens is we need to neutralize, we need to titrate with known volume of the standard volume of acid solution. Now, students, here one thing we need to note is we don't know exactly how much amount of ammonia is being liberated from the coal. So, what we are doing is we are approximately using some quantity of acid. So, whatever the amount of acid has been used, it will be used. Now, if more amount of nitrogen, if you are using certain amount of acid, this particular acid will be neutralized, will be used by the liberated ammonia. And the remaining whatever is left off, we can use this unused acid, we can titrate with some base, with some standard base. So, whatever the acid has been used, How do we know that? Based on the amount of the asset unused. So from the amount of asset unused, we can find out exactly what is the asset that is used by ammonia. From ammonia, we can find out the percentage of nitrogen there. So from the volume of acid used by ammonia, we can find out exactly the percentage of nitrogen. So I repeat once again here, whatever what we are doing is, from the liberated ammonia, we try to treat it with a standard volume of acid. Since we don't know exactly how much is the volume of or how much is ammonia liberated, whatever has to be reacted with ammonia, it has reacted. The remaining of acid has been unused. It is left off. So whatever the acid that is left off or unused, that will be made to titrate with NaOH solution. So from the amount of acid unused, we can find out, whatever the acid that has been used by NaOH solution, if you subtract it, that we get the amount of acid used by ammonia. From there, we can find out the percentage of nitrogen. And this is what is the formula. You students, this is a neutralization formula, that is normality into the volume of acid used into 1.4 into 100 by weight of coal taken. Now, what is the significance? Now, this is one thing which you need to understand is, nitrogen has no calorific value at all. It has zero calorific value. So, from this we can understand that if the percentage of nitrogen is very low, that means the quality of coal will be good, or it will have high calorific value. Least the percentage of nitrogen, greater is the quality of coal. Next, sulfur. Now next one we have is sulfur. This also forms the important element in the decision of or in the burning capacity or find the calorific value of the coal. In order to find out the amount of percentage of sulfur, what we do is, you can see here, this one is called as bomb calorimeter. Now, bomb calorimeter, it is an apparatus where we are finding out the calorific value of the solid fuel. And you can see that this is a crucible, students, here. Now, this particular portion, this is a small crucible where you are placing the solid fuel and you are burning. Now, when you burn, what happens is, based on the formula, that is amount of heat liberated is equal to amount of heat absorbed. So, from that process, from that formula, we get the calorific value of the solid fuels. You can see that, to see that no amount of heat gets out or it is not escaping out, we see when you can see that it is completely insulated, the walls of the calorimeter is completely insulated. So here it is completely heat absorbed by water, that is heat absorbed is equal to heat liberated. From there you can find out the calorific value. Of course, that is not important to us right now, but when this particular coal burns completely, there goes combustion, then whatever the residue that you have, this will have sulfur content. Traces of sulfur content that is present in the residue after it is completely burnt, what happens is we are adding barium chloride compound to it. Now, when barium chloride is added to it, you all know that the sulfur that is present in the residue that is remaining in the crucible, it combines with barium chloride and it forms barium sulfate. So, from that particular product, barium sulfate, we try to find out the percentage of sulfur. How do we get it? Let's see now. The weight of barium sulfate that is obtained into 32. Now, you all know that 32. What is this 32? It is the weight of your sulfur. Okay. Atomic weight of sulfur. So, sulfur in total molecular weight. Now, you can see that molecular weight of barium sulfate, it is 233. That means 32 grams of sulfur is present in 233 grams of barium sulfate. So, in the total weight of barium sulfate, how much is the percentage of or weight is the, how much is the weight of sulfur? From that, you can get the percentage of sulfur. Now, one thing I want you to understand is, Sulfur also forms the basis for your contribution to the calorific value of the coal. But one thing is, this sulfur has a disadvantage. A major disadvantage of sulfur is it combines with oxygen and forms sulfur dioxide, which has a problem of corrosion. It has the problem, disadvantage of having harmful effects of corroding the equipment. And not only that, students, you also know that sulfur dioxide, trioxide, all these are pollution causing gases. So they do give calorific value, but they also has this side effects. They has the problem of corrosion and also problem of pollution. So that reason we say that sulfur should be present in the coal, but in the minimum percentage. So this is a problem of sulfur. Now next one we have is ash. So already we have discussed about the ash when we were dealing with the proximate analysis. So how do we get the percentage of ash, students? We are taking the coal and again heating for 1 hour, half an hour, for about 700 degrees centigrade. Heat, cool, again find out the weight. We process, we continue this process till we get the constant weight. Now when we are sure about that there is no change in the weight, finally we will assume that the residue that is obtained is ash. We will get the percentage of ash by using this formula. Now weight of ash left is equal to weight of coal taken into 100. And we also discussed the problem what is the disadvantage of having ash. So what is the disadvantage? One thing is no contribution to the energy contribution to the coal. Second one is present, but there is no contribution. Number one, and next one is it is blocking, it blocks the spaces, students. It acts as a hindrance, or it blocks the spaces between the blocks, between the coals, and doesn't allow the oxygen supply to enter inside. That means it decreases the combustion capacity or the burning process of the coal, thereby decreasing the calorific value of the coal. So this is the problem of ash. Now finally we have is oxygen abundant that is present in the atmosphere. So how do we get the percentage of oxygen? Add all the elements, that is we have discussed the carbon, we have discussed the hydrogen, followed with sulfur, nitrogen and ash. Now all these elements percentage, whatever we have got, we shall add it and we subtract it from 100, we'll get the percentage of oxygen. Now students, oxygen also has contribution towards the calorific value of the coal. But what happens is, as I told you, that it is fixed with hydrogen. Always, never in the isolated form, it is fixed with the hydrogen. Thereby what happens, it forms moisture. And as I told you that moisture is a problem to the coal, because moisture adds weight, it quenches fire. No calorific or no energy contribution to the coal. So the main disadvantage of the formation of moisture is because of this oxygen. So oxygen decreases the calorific value of the coal. That means we can finally say that a good quality coal should have low percentage of oxygen. This is what is done. Now here, let's if you go back to the previous slides, carbon and hydrogen, students. Carbon, these carbon should be present in the maximum percentage. So if you can review it once again, carbon is the basis for the calorific value of the coal. So its percentage should be maximum, it should be present in the highest percentage. Second one is, yes, hydrogen also should be present, but it has a slighter problem of formation of moisture. Nitrogen, it doesn't account for any calorific value of the fuel. It has zero calorific value. So least percentage of nitrogen, better is the quality of coal. Next is sulfur. Sulfur is attributing or account, it contributing the energy or the calorific value to the coal, but has a problem of corrosion and polluting the equipment, environmental pollution and corroding the equipment. So it should be present, but in the least percentage. Lower the percentage of sulfur, greater is the quality of coal. And as you all know that as should be present in a very, very least percentage. So these are the main important elements which are responsible for the calorific value: carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur. And this is all about your ultimate analysis. So thank you.